Hello, Fleet, and welcome back to another episode of Know Your Ship with me, Chase. And today's episode is about the Admiral Hipper class heavy cruisers. These heavy cruisers served for the German Kriegsmarine during World War II. However, before getting into the actual episode, I would like to say one thing. It was really awesome seeing some of you in World of Warships this past weekend. I hope you all had fun, and I look forward to seeing you during the next weekend event. Also, I do apologize for not getting to this episode sooner. I've been spending a lot of time playtesting World of Warships and doing giveaways, but hopefully I'll be able to get to more episodes in the next little while. Also, some of you probably have noticed that there are a lot of people who've actually posted gameplay videos of World of Warships, and you might be wondering why I haven't posted anything yet. It's actually because we are actually all under the non-disclosure agreement, and I don't want to violate it. However, once the NDA is lifted, you can bet I'll be posting tons of stuff that are World of Warships related. Anyways, back to this actual Admiral Hipper episode. The Admiral Hipper class comprised of three ships that were completed and put into service, the Admiral Hipper, the Blücher, and the ever-famous Prinz Eugen. This video will hopefully give you an idea of what these ships did during World War II, and also their fates at the end. Aside from all that, I hope you all sit back, relax, and enjoy this episode on the Admiral Hipper class heavy cruisers.
The heavy cruisers, Admiral Hipper and Blücher, following a more conventional design, were among the most effective of their class in any navy of the world. They were heavily armoured, displaced 14,000 tons, and mounted 8 8-inch and 12 4.1-inch guns. In the weeks following the Altmark incident, Hitler received many reports that Britain intended to mine Norwegian waters and occupy Norwegian ports. On the 2nd of April, he announced that Weserabung would be launched at 0515 on the 9th of April. Between the 3rd and the 6th of April, transport and tanker groups set sail from Germany's Baltic ports. And then in the early hours of the 7th of April, Admiral Leutchens gave the order for Gneisenau to rendezvous with the battlecruiser Scharnhorst and 10 destroyers carrying 2,000 troops for Narvik. Also at sea were the heavy cruiser Admiral Hipper and 4 destroyers with 1,700 troops for Narvik. They steamed north in steadily worsening weather. Battered by a westerly gale, the destroyers had difficulty maintaining the 26 knots set by Gneisenau. As dawn broke on the 8th, 3 of the destroyers had become separated from the convoy. Meanwhile, at Scapa Flow, reconnaissance reports indicated that enemy warships were sailing north at high speed along the Norwegian coast. To Admiral Forbes, all was clear. They would skirt the Norwegian coast and then drive west, breaking out into the North Atlantic. The chance for the big all-gun battle had come at last. Forbes ordered the troops already on board cruisers and destroyers for Operation R4 to disembark, and then sent the home fleet racing northeast, chasing the tail of the German task force. He also alerted Admiral Whitworth aboard the battlecruiser Renown, which was off Narvik and sailing south along the Norwegian coast, directly towards the German convoys, to be on the lookout for a German attempt to break west. Forbes had the German fleet in a vice, but he didn't know it. The first encounter between the fleets was accidental. One of the Renown's escorts, the destroyer Glowworm, had become separated from the rest of the force on the 6th of April. Shortly after dawn on the 8th of April, about 100 miles northwest of Trondheim, she blundered into the destroyers Hans Ludemann and Anim, also out of contact with their task force. For nearly an hour, in mountainous seas, the destroyers exchanged ineffectual fire, which brought the heavy cruiser Admiral Hipper into the fray. Hipper's salvos brought down Glowworm's foremast and the radio aerials. Recognizing that escape was impossible, Glowworm's captain, Lieutenant Commander Broadmead Roop, closed on Hipper and launched 5 torpedoes, all of which missed. Hit again by an 8-inch shell, Glowworm fired her last torpedoes and then swung directly for Hipper. Plunging through the waves at 20 knots, the 1,300-ton destroyer smashed into the starboard hull of the Hipper, ripping away some 130 feet of armor plating and her torpedo tubes. As Glowworm fell away, Hipper's guns raked her. The Germans managed to pluck only 31 survivors out of the freezing, heaving Norwegian sea.
These are the last photos of the HMS Glowworm as she engaged the Admiral Hipper. Her ramming of the Admiral Hipper damaged one of the cruiser's torpedo tubes, flooded 2 compartments, and put the fresh water systems out of action. While the damage was relatively minor, the Hipper did have to be docked for repairs. At 10:24, the glowworm's boilers exploded, taking 109 members of her crew with her. The Admiral Hipper stopped to take on survivors, and even though they initially brought up 40 British sailors, six of them later succumbed to their wounds. The captain of the glowworm, Lieutenant Commander Roop, was seen in the water, but never made it aboard the Hipper. Captain Hayes of the Hipper wrote to the British authorities via the Red Cross, giving a statement of the courage shown by Lieutenant Commander Roop, which led to him being posthumously awarded the Victoria Cross, the first Victoria Cross handed out during the Second World War.
Though heroic, the battle between Glowworm and Hipper indicated that the Royal Navy's command and control was poor. Having picked up a brief radio signal from Glowworm, Forbes raced ships to the location. Failing to make contact, Forbes concluded that the Germans had turned west. Apparent confirmation was soon to come. During the afternoon, the German Trondheim group had reached its objective, but changed course several times while it waited for the appointed hour, 05:15, the following morning. A British aircraft, seeing it tacking to the west, radioed the news to Admiral Whitworth aboard Renown. The battlecruiser and her accompanying destroyers now raced off westward, leaving the approaches to Narvik clear. Upon receiving the same message, Admiral Forbes, 120 miles south of Trondheim, also veered westward. Having trapped the bulk of the German Navy, the home fleet now released it, speeding away in search of its elusive big gun battle. At 0400 on the 9th of April, Renown at last stumbled upon Gneisenau and Scharnhorst and opened fire, destroying Gneisenau's main fire control equipment. Leutchens sped off northeast, covering his trail with a smokescreen. He had no desire to hazard Germany's big ships. Besides, their job was done. They'd safely delivered the German invasion force to 5 points along the Norwegian coast, something that was just beginning to dawn on the British. All along the Norwegian coast, German amphibious forces were now approaching their disembarkation points. The transport Roder, carrying Luftwaffe personnel and anti-aircraft guns to Stavanger, was sunk by the Norwegian destroyer Sleipner. Admiral Hipper and her escort had a less eventful time, entering the harbour at Trondheim at 05:25, completely surprising the undermanned coastal batteries. At Bergen, the cruisers Kohn and Konigsberg, heading a force of 2 transports and 8 small torpedo boats, bluffed their way past batteries by signalling that they were a British task force. At Narvik, Commodore Bonte, leading the destroyer flotilla in the Wilhelm Heide camp, entered the harbour and sank the guardship Eistvold. Meanwhile, the destroyer Anim, threading her way through the shipping which packed the harbour, torpedoed the Norge, which exploded into flame, rolled over, and sank. Gripped by general panic, the Norwegian garrison slipped away. Meanwhile, far to the south, the heavy cruiser Blücher, accompanied by the pocket battleship Lutzow and light cruiser Emden and 13 smaller craft, had entered Oslo Fjord at about 0400. An hour later, as the Germans were slipping past Drubak, where the fjord narrows to only 600 yards, Norwegian batteries opened fire. Blücher, hit in the magazine, exploded. She capsized and sank with the loss of over 1,000 men.
May 21, 1941. The Bismarck crewmen anxiously wait for nightfall to launch their secret mission. But soon, they eye trouble in the sky.
And I wondered, what is that plane doing here? It was a Spitfire, no doubt about it.
A British reconnaissance plane spots the Bismarck and the Prinz Eugen and takes this now famous photograph. The German plan to keep Bismarck's mission a secret is now dashed. The British know that danger is imminent and Bismarck is a serious threat.
She was something which we all felt in the Royal Navy had to be destroyed, had to be cornered and attacked and sunk.
By 1941, Britain is the last enemy standing. Despite suffering heavy German air attacks, the country is still defiant. The Royal Navy controls the seas, but Bismarck is a challenge to even its best ships. The British need to find her and eliminate her. Evening, May 21st. Despite being spotted by the British, the German ships leave Norway to carry out Exercise Rhine. Before setting sail, Prinz Eugen tops off her fuel tanks, but Bismarck does not. a decision that will later come to haunt the Germans. Evening, May 21st, 1941. Bismarck foolishly doesn't refuel before leaving the fjord, but other earlier mistakes are already in play. The coming change of seasons may help explain the Germans' haste in getting Bismarck out to sea. German admirals hope the long Arctic nights will provide a helpful cover of darkness as the battleship breaks through into the Atlantic. But by the month of May, nights are getting shorter and time is running out.
The other factor was the development of new radar technology.
Both sides are evenly matched in new advances in radar that use radio signals to see distant objects. But they use this technology in different ways.
The Germans in the first line used radar technology as a means of range finding for artillery purposes, while the British relied on radar as a detection device.
Which proves a decisive advantage in the battle to come. Two British cruisers keep watch in the Denmark Strait, one of the possible corridors into the Atlantic. On May 23rd, they spot the German ships.
When Bismarck encountered the heavy cruisers Suffolk and Norfolk in the Denmark Strait, she rapid-fired her main caliber guns at these two cruisers. And that knocked out her main radar antenna.
For the first time on her maiden voyage, the Bismarck fires, but hurts only herself. Hastily installed, Bismarck's forward radar antenna can't withstand the shock of her own powerful armament. Now her radar abilities are significantly reduced.
This led to the changing of position of Bismarck and Prinz Eugen.
Undetected by the British, the Prinz Eugen, with all her radar installation still intact, takes the lead. Meanwhile, British heavy units are drawing near from the south, including the brand new battleship Prince of Wales and the flagship of the Royal Navy, the Hood. Launched in 1918, her victorious career earned her the nickname, the Mighty Hood.
People felt that the Hood was unsinkable. No ship is unsinkable, but they had this fantasy in their minds.
With the Suffolk and the Norfolk on their heels, the German ships steamed toward the open Atlantic and their first battle. On board the Prince of Wales, preparations are in full swing.
And we were able to plot the course and position of the Bismarck and work out exactly what time we should be meeting her in the morning. Well, this, of course, was very exciting to know that you were going to have the hell of a battle at, say, 5:30, which, if I remember right, was about the time.
And at 5:35 a.m., the Prinz Eugen, followed by the Bismarck, detects the two British ships on the horizon.
We thought nothing could happen. The Bismarck is unsinkable, and we will wipe out everything.
The Bismarck versus the Mighty Hood. Two enemy flagships face off. A duel of giants is about to begin, and only one will survive. May 24th, 1941. The British battlecruiser Hood and battleship Prince of Wales are in position at the western end of the Denmark Strait, ready to pounce on the Bismarck and the Prinz Eugen. The gap is closing. The Prince of Wales spots Bismarck.
After a few minutes, one suddenly saw a mast come up, and that was a very exciting moment. The mast was followed by a great big bar. Shortly after that, her funnel began to come up, and gradually the whole of the Bismarck came in sight.
But the British battlecruiser Hood makes a fateful mistake. From a distance, the massive silhouettes of the two German ships look the same.
Hood misidentified Prinz Eugen, which was the lead ship in the German task force, as Bismarck, and Hood was firing against Prinz Eugen, in essence, the wrong target.
Behind the Prinz Eugen, Bismarck readies for action and brings the British ships into her sights. She fires her first salvo against the right target.
It almost immediately straddles Hood.
Even with her radar broken, Bismarck's sophisticated aiming systems perform perfectly.
Again, another straddle, so they know they're shooting very well.
And there were huge fountains of water went up from the big shells.
With each salvo, the guns zero in on Hood.
And the ones that went over, passed over us, it sounded like a lot of express trains going over.
Admiral Holland turns the Hood toward the Bismarck at top speed. He knows he has to close the distance to avoid the gunfire that could put a shell in the most vulnerable part of his ship, the decks. Bismarck steers to optimal firing position to allow both her forward and aft turrets, the source of her immense power, to fire on Hood.
If you want to score three hits, you had to get about 100 shells into the air.
Battleships and battle cruisers are heavily armored along their sides, but the Hood is vulnerable. The armor under her decks is thin. Now she's at the optimal range for Bismarck's attack.
Admiral Holland's on the bridge of the Hood. He's trying to close the gap between him and Bismarck as fast as possible because he knows his ship is very vulnerable to plunging fire.
Bismarck fires again. One of her shells pierces the thin armor right above the magazine, and Hood's highly explosive 15-inch shells.
And the ship, the Hood, blew up like a great sort of Christmas cracker.
It was a very nasty shock. It was probably the worst shock I had in the whole war, now that I come to think of it.
In a duel that lasts only about 8 minutes, Hood's crew of more than 1,400 men vanishes in an instant. Only three survive.
It made all of us in the Navy feel even more strongly that whatever happened, we must try and get the Bismarck cornered.
A 14-inch shell from one of the Prince of Wales' main guns rips completely through Bismarck's bow, rupturing a fuel tank and letting seawater rush in. The shell strikes Bismarck near the deck and blows a massive exit hole near the waterline on the opposite side. Bismarck's crew suffers a deadly hit.
That was pretty decisive, because water came in and we were leaving an oil slick behind.
That's a problem.
About 1,000 tons of fuel was now rendered useless, and so this deprived Bismarck of the valuable fuel that she needed for commerce raiding.
Fuel to conduct her far-ranging mission across the Atlantic. Fuel she could have topped off in Norway while still in German-controlled waters, a decision that now proves pivotal.
With a reduced speed, she still could hit, but she could not run anymore.
The damage is severe. The Bismarck is losing fuel and she can't run at top speed. Admiral Lucians turns for the nearest port in German-occupied France for repairs. Following new orders, Prinz Eugen continues on her own. After only 6 days at sea, Exercise Rhine, Bismarck's first mission to strike Allied shipping, is canceled.
However, after detaching from the battleship Bismarck, the Prinz Eugen's mission didn't exactly go according to plan. She suffered major machinery problems and was forced to return to France. She spent the next 8 months undergoing repairs in Brest, and the next time she would see major action was during the Channel dash with the Scharnhorst and the Nisenau.
After the loss of the Bismarck, the German Navy was loath to take risks with its few remaining capital ships. For the most part, they stayed at anchor in strongly protected ports under Royal Navy blockade and subject to frequent but usually ineffectual attacks from British bombers. This inaction did not appeal to Hitler, who in any case was now convinced that the big ships have had their day. A squadron of his largest ships, the Scharnhorst, the Gneisenau and the Prinz Eugen, was lying in Brest harbour. In December 1941, Hitler ordered that the three warships were to attempt a breakout to northern waters, for he feared an invasion of Norway. The risks appalled Admiral Raeder, but Hitler told him the alternative was to have the ships broken up and their guns redeployed as shore defences. In February 1942, the famous Channel Dash took place. Surprise and good luck favoured the Germans. When the German armed convoy left Brest, the British submarine standing guard outside had withdrawn. After steaming at high speed through the night, the ships continued unobserved until mid-morning on the 12th, when they were spotted by a Spitfire pilot. He signalled an urgent report, but the initial British response was slow and disorganised. The great convoys swept on. Escorting the three big warships were 10 destroyers and numbers of fast torpedo boats and E-boats. The Luftwaffe had stripped a huge area of its defences to provide continuous strong air cover for the ships. Throughout the day, the British attacked with almost everything to hand. Many bombers were lost to the marauding Messerschmitts and Fokker Wolfs. Shore batteries opened up with their heavy guns, to no avail. Torpedo boats and destroyers went into action, but achieved nothing. By afternoon, the German ships, well nigh unscathed, were pressing on fast into the North Sea, and the weather was thickening. They had got away, and the only real damage that was done happened that evening when the Gneisenau struck a mine. Not since the time of the Spanish Armada had a hostile fleet attempted to force the English Channel.
Operation Cerberus was home and dry. Admiral Ciliax radioed Navy Group West, "It is my duty to inform you that Operation Cerberus has been successfully completed." The Kriegsmarine had scored a brilliant tactical victory, and in the process had humiliated the Royal Navy and Bomber Command. But the elation of its seamen concealed the fact that Operation Cerberus represented an overall strategic setback from which the Kriegsmarine would never recover. Admiral Raeder was on hand to award one of Germany's highest awards, the Knight's Cross, to Ciliax and Hoffmann. Hoffmann was also promoted to Rear Admiral. But by withdrawing its surface forces to Germany, the Kriegsmarine had removed the threat they had posed while they remained on the Atlantic seaboard in northern France. Bletchley Park had received early intelligence of the mine damage to Scharnhorst and Gneisenau. RAF Bomber Command was determined to exact revenge. On the 27th of February, Gneisenau was badly damaged by a heavy air raid on Kiel, where she lay in a floating dock. She never set to sea again, and ended her days as a blockship in Poland. Meanwhile, Prinz Eugen had set sail for Norway. Her movements were pinpointed by Bletchley Park, enabling the submarine Trident to blow off her stern. The Kriegsmarine was forced to reassess the role of its surface fleet. Scharnhorst and Gneisenau were both out of action, the latter for the duration of the war. The battleship Tirpitz was now in northern Norwegian waters, harboured at Narvik. But the pocket battleships Admiral Scheer and Lützow, the former Deutschland, could not keep pace with her as escorts. The heavy cruiser Admiral Hipper could keep up with Tirpitz, but her crew had not worked up to battle readiness. These problems were compounded by an acute shortage of fuel. The surface fleet seemed to be a blunt sword. it was left to Admiral Dönitz's U-boat arm to bear the brunt of the naval war in the Arctic. The U-boats scored their biggest success in the Arctic War in July 1942, when they mauled the ill-fated convoy PQ-17, outward bound to Murmansk. The original plan for the operation had envisaged a combination of U-boats, surface ships and aircraft. Tirpitz and Hipper were to draw off the escort, allowing Scheer and Lützow to move in for the kill. The surface ships set sail on the 1st of July. But the next day, Hitler ordered them back into Altenfjord, fearful that there were aircraft carriers escorting the convoy. Once again, Bletchley Park's codebreakers were keeping abreast of developments. But the First Sea Lord, Admiral Sir Dudley Pound, remained convinced that the German heavy units were still at sea. On the 4th of July, he ordered the convoy to scatter, 24 hours before the capital ships re-emerged from Altenfjord with the intention of attacking the convoy on the 6th. But with the convoy already scattered, the execution was done by U-boats and aircraft. Of PQ-17's 34 ships, only 11 survived. The next convoy, PQ-18, was more heavily guarded, and only 8 ships were sunk. There were no more convoys that summer, as the Allies were readying themselves for Operation Torch, the seaborne invasion of North Africa. By the time the convoys resumed in December, the Arctic U-boats had returned to the Atlantic. This left only the main units of the surface fleet as an increasingly uncertain offensive weapon against the convoys to Russia. After another abortive attack, Hitler decided to break up the big surface ships. Admiral Raeder was replaced by Admiral Dönitz, whose U-boats were causing havoc among the Allied convoys in the Atlantic. Dönitz persuaded Hitler not to take such drastic measures. The heavy units were saved from the scrapyard, and the new naval chief began to shuffle his dog-eared pack.
The two remaining Admiral Hipper class ships had a rather quiet end to the war. The Admiral Hipper spent pretty much the rest of the war out of action, either in a repair dock or not having a full crew to operate her. Her end finally came on May 3, 1945, when she was bombed by RAF bombers and was so badly damaged that the crew scuttled her. She was raised in July 1945 and scrapped from 1948 to 1952. Her sister ship, the Prinz Eugen, did not engage in further naval combat in the last 2 years of the war. She was primarily used as either an artillery support ship against advancing Soviet troops, or as an escort for German transport ships as they evacuated German troops from Finland. By the end of the war, the Prinz Eugen and the light cruiser Nuremberg were the only major German ships to have survived World War II. The Prinz Eugen was awarded to the United States as a war prize and was commissioned into the U.S. Navy as the USS Prinz Eugen. Her career in the U.S. Navy was short-lived, as she would be expended during the atomic bomb test in Bikini Atoll in 1946. And that's all, folks, for this Know Your Ship episode on the Admiral Hipper-class heavy cruisers. Some of you might have noticed that these episodes are taking me a lot longer to produce, namely because a lot of these ships have never had any sort of documentary that's actually focused on them, so I am trying to piece together footage from random documentaries to try and have them tell a cohesive story. Anyways, I do hope you enjoyed this episode. If you did, don't forget to like this video and subscribe to my channel. Stay tuned, as I'm trying to make episodes as fast as I humanly can. And aside from all that, I hope you all have a fantastic week, and I'll see you all on the high seas soon.